If the Democrats get in, they're going to raise your taxes. You're going to have crime all over the place. You're going to have people pouring across the border. So why would that be a blue wave? I think it could be a red wave. I tell you what. Really, I think it should be a red wave.
Well, if a blue wave does materialize in November, it could wind up cresting in what used to be the most politically predictable region of the country, the South. Tennessee and Georgia have Dems ahead in early polls. Tennessee for the U.S. Senate and Georgia for what could be an historic governor's race. While in Texas, Beto O'Rourke is making Republican Senator Ted Cruz sweat. So is the once solid red South looking more purple? Joining me now to discuss is Columbus, Georgia Mayor Teresa Tomlinson. Back with me is David Jolly and Jason Johnson, and also joining Republican strategist Kayton Dawson. Thank you all. And all right, I'm going to start with you, Mayor Tomlinson. Let's go to Georgia. You and I have talked a lot about this race. Stacey Abrams, incredibly enough, polling within the margin of error, but 2 points ahead of Brian Kemp. That's a Gravis poll from July 27th through July 29th. Does Stacey Abrams have a realistic shot at winning that race?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, the three top tickets holders there with our governor position, lieutenant governor with Sarah Amico, and also John Barrow with Secretary of State are all polling ahead of their Republican opponents. And we have a very strong candidate, too, for Attorney General in Charlie Bailey. So our ticket's looking very strong. But let me just say, we have finally cracked the code on how to win back the South. You know, we're no Kansas, we're no Oklahoma. We have not been that red for that long, by the way. We just lost the governor's mansion in 2002. Thereafter, it took a couple of years for the Senate and the House to switch over to Republican control. So people are out there that remember voting for Democrats. So remember when Democrats were in control of all both houses and the governor's mansion. So, but I will tell you what we've learned is that Democrats can certainly turn out those voters in urban areas, Atlanta, Columbus, Savannah. Certainly, we know how to do that. But frankly, we've ignored a lot of Democrats in South Georgia, and South Georgia is a Democratic area. We know now from polling dozens and dozens of counties in our Black Belt, and that refers to the agrarian area of rich soil, not to the color of anyone's skin. But dozens and dozens of those counties are actually Democratic counties. We've given them no love for many, many years. Stacey Abrams, the Democratic ticket, is out there humping it through those areas. These are areas that have sometimes 30 to 40% poverty rates. We've lost 10 rural hospitals under Republican control over the last 8 years and a little prior to that. And so these are folks that understand that government is a partner in their prosperity. They understand that we need to elect people that believe in government and that understand how to run it. And Democrats are speaking to that message.
And very quickly, to stay with you, Mayor Tomlinson, what are the issues? Is it health care that is helping these Democratic candidates come back in Georgia?
A couple of things. Expanding Medicare has a 73% approval rating in Georgia, okay? And that holds solid, too, for this area I'm talking about in South Georgia that many pundits, many analysts write off as being the rural red. That's just not true. They want expansion of Medicare. Also, Trump's so-called tax cut plan, it only has about a 37, 39% approval rating in Georgia. So, and Trump himself is floating around, if you average all the polls, 40% approval rating in Georgia. So I think that people are painting with too broad a red brush when they try to make Georgia sound like it's a deep red state. It simply is not. But the people in these areas are looking for prosperity. They're looking at the opportunity for economic development, which you cannot have if you don't have basic financial infrastructure, infrastructure like hospitals, access to health care. And Democrats are speaking directly to those issues. Republicans, on the other hand, and we have drawn, fortunately, for Democrats, a pretty weak slate of Republican candidates here. We've got Kemp, of course, has spent millions of dollars in months telling us he doesn't like brown people. Well, there's 46% of the active registered voters in Georgia are non-white. That's going to be a problem for him.
All right, let's play one of the Brian Kemp's ads, because a lot of, I'm going to go to you on this, Kayton, because, you know, the sort of the scuttlebutt was that the Republican Party writ large would have preferred to have the other guy, not Brian Kemp, but Donald Trump preferred Kemp, Kemp won. Here's Brian Kemp's ad, one of his ads about immigration.
I'm Brian Kemp. I'm so conservative. I blow up government spending. I own guns that no one's taken away. My chainsaw's ready to rip up some regulations. I got a big truck, just in case I need to round up criminal illegals and take them home myself. Yep, I just said that. I'm Brian Kemp. If you want a politically incorrect conservative, that's me.
Kane, is that still going to work in a state like Georgia that does seem to be getting a little more purple?
It sure works in the primary, as you see from the numbers. In Georgia, President Trump only won Georgia by 5%. So the mayor's right. Georgia's new to the Republican Party as far as the changeover from Democratic to Republican rule. But I would caution you that Nathan Deal's a pretty popular governor. In a lot of these southern states, we've all got governor's races, which is a very personal vote. So the Republicans aren't going to just lay down and let the Democratic Party roll all over them in Texas, Tennessee, Georgia, Florida. Florida's the most fertile ground, in my opinion, of all of the states right now for the Democratic Party. But we'll see. We got to distance ourselves from these primaries. Everybody knows that your bases help get you to the party, but it's the people who didn't vote in either primary that matter, and how the parties are going to be defined when we get closer to November. Mm-hmm. The Republicans have a high hill to climb right now. I mean, just history tells you that we've got trouble coming in November.
Yeah. And let me go to you, Jason Johnson. You've been our resident Georgia skeptic in a lot of ways as far as the Democratic Party. But which of these states seems to be the most fertile ground for Democrats right now? Because Tennessee, you know, Phil Bredesen is ahead in pretty much every poll that we've seen, ahead of Marsha Blackburn. In Texas, Beto O'Rourke, darn close to Ted Cruz. Which of these is the most fertile ground for Democrats, would you say?
If I had to rank them, I would say Tennessee first. I think Bredesen. I think he's just going to beat Blackburn. He is just such a popular candidate, and you've got Bob Corker basically coming out and saying, like, I can't run against this guy. He's too good. Second, I am moving less out of my cynicism column. I have to mention Georgia. Look, the Republican Governors Association just dumped $700,000 into this race. You don't do that if you think that you've got this locked up. You've got Brian Kemp. I was talking to some representatives here this weekend. Brian Kemp is not very popular with a lot of suburban voters. That is going to be a problem for him this fall. And also, and this is really key, this hasn't gotten a lot of attention yet, there's a real conflict of interest with Brian Kemp being the Republican gubernatorial nominee and also being Secretary of State. He shut down the online voter registration for Georgia for 30 hours for maintenance this weekend, a weekend where a lot of people are going out to register people to vote. You don't do that unless, one, you're a vote suppressor, or two, you're nervous. So I really think Tennessee and Georgia are the two places where we might see a huge flip this fall.
And David Jolly, you're a former Florida congressman, Republican congressman. We are looking at this spectacle where Democrats could win the Tennessee Senate race and lose the Senate seat in Florida, because actually the incumbent Bill Nelson is behind.
Yeah, look, that could be the anomaly in a blue wave. Rick Scott, whatever you think of his politics, is an incredibly disciplined campaigner. Stays away from the media, goes on air, spends his own money. Bill Nelson has not had a tough race in about 18 years, probably. But reports are he's about to spend and spend big. He knows this is going to be a big race. You know, one of the interesting things come out of Florida politics on the Democratic side, Gwen Graham continues to be disciplined on a message about ending 20 years of one-party control. She clearly seen something in the numbers. You have the progressive in Andrew Gillum, who is saying, I'm the only non-millionaire in the race. Stick with me. He's got Bernie Sanders endorsement. And then you do have the real billionaire class coming in, particularly Jeff Green, who's spending $40 million in 2 months to try to win this.
All right, very quickly, lightning round. I'm going to start with you, David. One-word answer. The state that will be the most surprising on election night. David.
I hope Texas, Beto.
Texas, okay. Caton.
And not going to be any surprises. The Republicans are going to do pretty well.
That's a multiple word answer. Jason Johnson, state that will be the most surprising.
Nobody likes Ted Cruz. I think Beto O'Rourke pulls it off.
All right. And I'm going to give Mayor Thompson. I think I know what you're going to say, but most surprising state.
It's going to be Georgia. No surprise to be me, but it's going to surprise Caton.
All right. Oh,
that's right.
Little shade in the panel. Mayor Teresa Tomlinson, David Jolly, Jason Johnson, Caton Dawson. Great panel. Thank you guys very much. And in our next hour, Trump is calling the press the enemy of the people again this morning and contradicting his earlier explanation of that Trump Tower meeting.